Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. Still have quite a few folks logging on, so we'll give them a few minutes to get settled and we'll get started in a few minutes here. Thanks. Thanks again, everyone, for joining us. Still gonna wait a few minutes here as we have quite a few folks just logging in, and I wanna give them a few minutes to get settled. We'll get started in just a few minutes. Thanks. All right, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar on how intelligent process automation drives growth and ROI in the financial services industry. My name is Jeremy Stinson, Director of Marketing at Indico, and I'll be your host for today's webinar. Before we go ahead and get started, I want to cover a few housekeeping items. First, the recording and slides will be sent out after the webinar is done. And lastly, we'll have 15 minutes of Q&A at the end of the webinar. But feel free to ask questions as they arrive as we're going through the slides, and we'll make sure to get to them at the end. Now I'd like to introduce today's presenter, Tom Wild. Tom is CEO of Indico Data. Tom also has 25 years of experience in enterprise search and is an expert in unstructured content technology and solutions. Thanks for joining us today, Tom. I'll hand it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Jeremy. And thanks, everyone, for joining us here. Wanted to start with a quick webinar agenda so you know what to expect. And then we'll dive right in. So just kicking it off, we'll give you a quick one-minute background on Indico and its relevance to this problem area. We'll talk about challenges in financial services as it relates to process automation with principally unstructured content, documents, emails, and all those kinds of items that flow through a typical financial services firm. We'll take a look at what the traditional approaches are today and why they're not solving the problem. What are the drawbacks? What are the challenges? What are the expenses in trying to solve this through approaches that have been used historically to deal with this? We'll talk about the breakthrough that we believe we've developed here to take care of what has typically been major impediments to trying to solve this problem. Structured data has had years and years of investment and things like data lakes and data warehouses and machine learning. Unstructured content really hasn't benefited from that sort of advancement until very recently. We'll talk to you about that. We'll do a quick demo, take you through some case studies, and then as Jeremy mentioned, we'll do a Q&A at the end here. Feel free to type questions into the question bar throughout the webinar as you think of them, and we'll do a roundup of the questions at the conclusion here. A quick information about Indico. We're a Boston-based company focused on enterprise AI to solve these process automation challenges as they relate to unstructured content. So text, image, documents, emails, all those things that make up valuable parts of how a company communicates internally and externally to customers, vendors, partners, et cetera. We work primarily with Fortune 1000 financial services and insurance companies, people who have big challenges and big opportunities if they're able to solve those challenges. And we were recently named a Gartner Cool Vendor in September for the work we've done in this space. So what are the challenges here facing a major financial services firm when you think about this kind of content? Well, typically, when we're talking to prospects and customers, there's really one or both of two key things that they're focused on. One is they're concerned that there's opportunity in all of this unstructured content that they can't get their hands on. Are there new product opportunities? Are there new ways to service the customer and enhance the outward-facing performance of the business by doing a better job with all this unstructured content? And then secondly, as a highly regulated industry, there's concerns about risk inside this content. That's compliance risk, audit risk, regulatory risk, how to understand what is in this content, get a hold of it, and then make it part of an overall risk management compliance and audit process that already exists, but typically isn't taking into account the unstructured portions of the content in the enterprise. What we see here over and over again is these manual document-based workflows are very pervasive in the financial service enterprise. And these things include processes such as customer onboarding and know your customer, trade order processing reconciliation, wire transfer, invoice reconciliation, collateral files, loan files, offering documents. All of these things are driven principally, or at least at the beginning of those processes, by some sort of unstructured content element, typically a document, probably most often a PDF, that exists as part of these manual workflows. And this unstructured and what we call semi-structured data is literally everywhere. It's hiding in plain sight is sort of the way I like to describe it. As we begin to talk to customers about this kind of content, you know, immediately they start to react and say, yes, we have that problem. Yes, we have that kind of content. And the reality is most haven't really tried to build automation into those kinds of processes yet because the perception has been that either it's too difficult, too expensive, or not tractable. And unstructured and semi-structured lives as these kinds of content elements. When we think about unstructured, typically that's things like contracts and emails, right? It's just a document with a lot of text in it. Maybe there's a little bit of structure in terms of section headings and paragraphs and things of that nature. Semi-structured is more traditional form-based information. The forms may be heterogeneous in that you may be getting forms from third parties. Invoices are always a good example, but things like trade order processes, mortgage appraisals, these are all semi-structured. The data that you expect is in there, but often its presentation and its location within the document varies from document to document, making this a particularly difficult problem when it comes to automation. And we'll talk about why traditional approaches have fallen short so far. What you end up with when you kind of crack open these processes, you know, which we do when we're talking to prospects, is first of all, as I mentioned, they're usually very manual. It's shocking how many manual processes exist in Fortune 1000 companies to make the business go, to deliver the service, to interact with the customer, to process the orders. A lot of times these are documents being passed from person to person for review, classification, annotation, and to execute on these processes that face the customer. That leads to inconsistencies because there's a predominance of manual effort involved here. There's quite a bit of variability in how these documents are processed. It makes audit and compliance and quality control very challenging. It's often difficult to reconstruct why a particular document was processed in a certain way, unless you can go find the person that actually did that processing. And obviously then it's expensive. It can be expensive in terms of the number of resources you have to put on a given process. You may be disappointing the customer with the cycle time required for that given process, or you may actually have regulatory risk from an inconsistent or error-prone process. Certainly in the banking space, some recent huge fines from the government for things like customer onboarding, know your customer, anti-money laundering, involving hundreds of millions of dollars. So not only is the process often expensive just on an out-of-pocket basis, the regulatory risk can be absolutely massive. So what's the goal? Obviously, as a process specialist, a line of business owner, or a product line owner, the kind of things you're hoping to achieve by attacking these kinds of problems and solving them through automation, decrease cycle time. How do you take a given process and dramatically reduce the turnaround time for a given document, which often has very beneficial impacts on your internal and external stakeholders? For external stakeholders in particular, i.e. customers, this becomes a competitive advantage versus your competition, and specifically fintech startups. So one thing that we hear quite often now is large financial institutions' concern about the fintech startups. Fintech startups get to come to market with very little of the overhead that bigger companies need to manage because they've been in business for a long time and have huge customer scale. So decreasing cycle time puts you on a better competitive footing with a lot of the fintech and insurtech startups. You get to redeploy resources. Obviously, that's a goal you're looking for. A lot of times you have very experienced, very skilled resources that are stuck doing repeatable tasks because they're the only ones that have the expertise to look at the documents in question and execute the process. Capturing that knowledge means that you go from sort of a cottage industry approach to these processes to institutional knowledge about these processes. We certainly see that in insurance, where it's not atypical to have people working these processes that have been at the companies for 20 or 30 years, and difficult in transferring that knowledge to new employees who come on board. So adding some augmentation or automation to that allows you to make better use of those resources and have them work on tasks that are higher value and require and take advantage of the experience that those employees have. And finally, increased throughput. This is really all about profitable growth. How do I grow my business next year on the top line without having to increase my expense on the operational side so that those profits drop to the bottom line? This notion of efficiency and profitable growth is probably the number one thing we hear in terms of the goals for trying to introduce automation into some of these processes. So why is this so difficult? I mean, this has been a problem for a long time. There have been a number of approaches to it. None of them have really dominated as solution sets, you know, given the scope and the size of this problem that's existed for so long. So let's dig into a little bit of what the barriers have been historically to dealing with unstructured content to make these processes more automated. Why is there so much manual processing that still exists out there? So let's start with text for a minute. Why is text difficult? As you can see there, you know, this little bit of an eye chart in terms of our table to the left, when you really unpack sort of how to understand text, there's a lot to it. It turns out that most computer-based approaches to dealing with unstructured content are based around an approach to solving keywords. Makes sense. Keywords are easy to spot. They're typically a binary object that a computer can make sense of. And you can build all sorts of rules and indexes to deal with keywords. The problem, it turns out, is that keywords are a particularly poor way to attack this problem. Context is what drives meaning. Keywords aren't really a good indicator of meaning. And when you're doing things like looking at contracts, looking at order forms, looking at policies, language will shift from document to document, even though the concept is the same. And until recently, computers weren't very good at understanding context, unless you gave them tremendous amounts of rules and instructions as to how to disambiguate keywords, how to make sense of keywords. And then you get into things like stemming, lemmatization, you have acronyms, you have out of vocabulary problems. What if it's never seen the word before? And pretty soon you have a very brittle approach to trying to solve unstructured when you use keywords as your primary knife edge there with this problem. And my background, you know, 25 years in search, I certainly have seen every possible way to torture keywords imaginable. And it got us a long way, but didn't get us all the way. And so we're excited to talk about what's next here. Another approach has been things like expert systems. An expert system is an approach where you attempt to sit down with all the stakeholders and codify their understanding of the problem into very complex nested rules. So that as the software begins to attack a new document or form, it uses an expert system series of cascading rules to make sense of what it's looking at. When done correctly and with the right amount of time invested, can work very successfully. The problem is very expensive to implement and very brittle. So the minute the content in question strays from the way the expert system expects it, it begins to break. This is sort of the challenge with IBM Watson. Watson has certainly taken their lumps more recently for sort of overstating their capabilities. And the reality is they have a very, very good expert system approach. However, it suffers from all the drawbacks and weaknesses that all expert systems do, which is they're insanely expensive to deploy and just brutal to maintain. You're stuck maintaining them forever. Therefore, most customers we talk to have said, we've tried expert system approaches and we abandoned it because of the intense expense in trying to scale it across our whole process. Another approach has been OCR. So the traditional OCR approach is to create sort of these masks over a given document, really trying to tell the system, hey, you need to look at this XY coordinate on this document to find the date or the customer name or the invoice item. And it relies on a very homogeneous set of documents so that the OCR always knows where to look on the document to find the given information. When the document strays from that strict formatting, visual formatting, you begin to see a breakdown in the scalability across these use cases. And what we see over and over again is there's far more heterogeneity of content and documents in these processes than people realize. It's quite typical for us to see that, you know, a maximum of 30% of the volume can be accounted for, you know, with a single form, and the rest of it is all long tail, heterogeneous type formatting and construction of these documents when they arrive at the customer. Invoices, trade orders, wire transfer requests, customer onboarding forms, these vary wildly from document to document, and traditional OCR approaches simply don't work. So what's the solution? If we have identified the problem as the sort of brittleness and expense of putting into place expert systems or OCR-based systems, if we've understood the challenges with trying to use keywords and that they don't understand context very well, well, a solution we need to take all those things into account in order to solve this. And certainly AI has been huge over the last 18 months in terms of its promises to solve everything. And it's true, AI is very, very good at what I'll call fuzzy problems like unstructured content. Things like heterogeneous documents, ambiguity in terms of context and scalability across use cases. Deep learning and AI are very, very good at this. However, it comes with a set of impediments that typically the enterprise can't overcome and therefore doesn't get to benefit from these advances. And that's, I think, in part why more enterprises haven't yet figured out how to automate unstructured content. First of all, to use deep learning and AI effectively, you need huge amounts of training data. Deep learning is really, really good at solving this problem. It's a very smart learner. It's a very slow learner. Typically, you'd need to label 100,000 examples of the documents in question for it to be able to perform robustly. If you're Google or Facebook, you may have that kind of scale, but I can assure you that I've yet to meet a single Fortune 1000 that could show up with more than a few hundred labeled examples. It takes expensive hardware. Deep learning runs on GPU-based hardware, and the more complex your use cases, the more hardware you have to throw at it. You typically need deep data science expertise to understand how to take advantage of advances in natural language processing using AI. And then finally, if you're working with a vendor, you want to make sure that there's no data leakage. You want to be able to have the option to deploy it on-premise or in your own private cloud, number one. And number two, you want to make sure that the IP you've created by building AI-based approaches to solve your problems isn't then taken and walked down the street and sold to a competitor, even in an abstracted form. You need to know that your data is your data at all times through the whole process. Under the new regulations with GDPR and other data protection acts, this is actually absolutely tantamount as a consideration when trying to solve some of these problems. The good news is that's what Indico set out to solve. We set out to make deep learning a practical approach for automating unstructured content processes and remove these barriers that have been preventing the enterprise from taking advantage of what is truly a breakthrough and paradigm shift in how these fuzzy problems can be solved as compared to even 3 or 4 years ago. So let's talk about how we do that. Indico has employed something called transfer learning. Transfer learning is a deep learning approach where a training set of data used to solve one problem is lifted up and used to solve an adjacent problem. Indico took what we like to call a more galactic approach to this. We built a massive generalized model that provides a huge bootstrap for our customers to allow them to build custom models on top of it. And think of a custom model as a little bot that is good at deconstructing an unstructured content problem like a document and doing the classification, extraction, and transformation that's required if you're going to tackle an unstructured content problem. And the way it works is this. Think of our little silicon tree metaphor here. The root system is really Indico. So we show up with this huge generalized model, solves about 99% of the training data requirement. It also is very computationally efficient. It runs on a single server, and then all of the custom models you build run on traditional CPU-based commodity hardware. So the compute profile here, when you're talking about AI, is an important consideration to the overall cost of deploying. What our customers get to do is build these little bots, these little custom models, with fewer than 100 labeled examples for the given task you're trying to solve. We found that this is a very tractable approach. Most of our customers, with their subject matter experts or line of business owners, can label 100 examples or fewer to create these robust custom models to interpret, understand, and automate document-based workflows. And I'll show you some more detail how that stitches together and also a demo of how you actually accomplish this data labeling task, which some of you may not be familiar with. As you start to learn about AI, the strength of AI comes from the strength of the labeled data that you can bring to the table. And that's a key piece of what Indico has solved with our intelligent process automation solution. And finally, you know, as an extension of that last point, there's been a lot of growth and discussion around this notion of the citizen data scientist and the citizen developer. What this really means is, how do you take the people who have the subject matter expertise at your company, typically analysts, line of business owners, process owners, how do you help them take that expertise and use it to leverage these breakthroughs in technology to make them function in a way that is customized and purpose-built for your organization? Many vendors have tried to approach this with sort of an out-of-the-box approach where, hey, it works as long as you can narrowly define your use case along the following lines and your data doesn't stray too far from their data assumptions. We took the opposite approach, which is we assume that you want to base your processes entirely on your own data and the IP you've developed and how you interpret that data and process that data. And so this notion of citizen data scientists means your subject matter experts are suddenly empowered with this technology without having to know data science. Your analysts and your subject matter experts are able to deploy these solutions without having to know, you know, Python or Java or anything like that. So these notions of the citizen empowerment in the enterprise is a critical one. Let's talk about a form extraction use case here for a second. Let's use a wire transfer process automation as an example here. So you have your inbound forms. Very typically, you know, if you're talking about a commercial wire transfer request, you'd have an email with some kind of PDF attached, giving the bank the instructions as to the from and the to and the account in question. And if it's a large institution, it may carry with it a set of legal releases in terms of approval to make this wire transfer. In essence, a lot of semi-structured and unstructured content in question from those forms. So the way you attack this is you would build, as I previewed on the recent slide there, a custom extraction model. And I'll show you how to do that in the demo, but essentially by labeling a few dozen of sample wire transfer forms, you teach the platform how to recognize all of those attributes within that form that you care about, that are required for you to execute that wire transfer. And once you've done that, it's able to identify those elements and extract those elements as a prep step to processing this wire transfer. The next step may be some kind of transformation or classification task. People may represent the dollar amount in different ways. Maybe they include the dollars and cents formatting. Maybe they don't. Maybe it's written out as 10,000 TEN. THOUSAND, maybe it's written with numbers and commas. That variability is often a killer when you're talking about OCR and other type approaches. It's why manual data entry has been so effective historically. Humans are really good at doing that just kind of automatically. And what you get out the other side, of course, is both the extracted elements and their transformed values and confidence scores. So if there are exceptions, you can route those for manual review and essentially dramatically cut the cycle time down, improve the accuracy and the throughput and scalability, and have the success in augmenting or automating this process. These custom models, think of those as bots, you can snap these together in any order and in any complexity. They range from a single custom model for some use cases, all the way up to, in the case of one project we've done around mortgage process automation, over two dozen models built and snapped together to automate a mortgage approval process. At the same time, I'll tell you that took about 2 weeks to craft those custom models and stitch them together. So this was nowhere near the typical many months implementation process that comes with trying to build an expert system to do that, as an example, and all the maintenance and cost to do that after the fact. Okay, so let me jump over to show you a quick demo of how easy this is. All right, so what we're looking at here is Indico Intelligent Process Automation. This is an application that we built, again, oriented towards the citizen data scientist and citizen developer. And the main value of Indico IPA is to quickly build these custom models slash bots, and also critically to understand the performance of those. Because the challenge with any AI-based approach is if you can't explain how it's working, if you can't test how it's working, then especially in regulated environments, you can't deploy that typically with respect to the compliance requirements and audit requirements. So let's take a look at Indico Teach. Indico Teach is where you actually go to begin creating these custom models. Again, as I mentioned, this process involves loading a set of sample documents. They can be quite variable, and having my subject matter experts come in and label a bit of that data to create this custom model. So you can see here, I've created what I call a teach task. And what I've done here is I've created the kind of labels I'm looking for within these documents. So in this case, we're going to use invoices as a simple example. I want my labelers to label the vendor, the amount, line items, total, the currency, invoice number, account number, and routing number. Those are the elements I've deemed as critical to extract and use and inject into my downstream, in this case, my downstream payables platform. When I create a teach task, I can set up some instructions for my labelers, and I can easily invite those labelers to this teach task by simply putting in their email and clicking submit. The labeler will get an email saying, hey, you've been invited to a labeling task, click here to begin. And what that looks like is this labeling task begin, and I'm gonna get these samples in front of me so I can begin to build the training required to make this model work. So you can see here, I've got an extraction from a sample invoice. This has simply been OCR'd, so I've pulled the text out of the invoice in question, and I can begin my labeling task. On the right-hand side, you can see that I've got my custom labels set up. And as a labeler, I can simply click on any of these labels, and you can see that my cursor changes colors so that I can underline and highlight the particular elements that I wish to label. In this case, we've labeled, as you can see at the top here, 37 invoices already out of the, in this case, we loaded 250, but we didn't need anywhere near that many to build a good model. And you can see that one thing we've also solved is helping the labeler understand when they've done enough labeling. And so what happens is as I begin to label some of these invoices, I've done 37 of them, the model begins to predict for me what the various elements are. So you can see here that this is predicting that Asana is the vendor in question, and it has high confidence. So if I think that's correct, I'll click accept. Then I have here an invoice number. Again, it is somewhat confident in that. I'm gonna tell it that it actually got it right. So that will help now reinforce my model, and my model just got smarter by me accepting that prediction. This is the line item. Again, it's quite confident in that, so I'm going to accept that. This is the dollar amount. It has growing confidence in this, but 37 is still a little bit on the low side, so we're still gonna do some more training. The same with this, it only has 41% confidence to date in this being the amount. So you can see that I'm kind of midway through a labeling task. Those percentages are pretty typical when I'm at, you know, 37 examples. But as you can see, you know, in a traditional deep learning setup, I might need 100,000 of these examples, and I'm nowhere near that, right? When I get to say 50 to 100 of these, it's going to be performing well. So once I've accepted these, I can click next, and I'm onto my next invoice to label. And you can see here that it's begun to make predictions, and you can see that it's already started to get more confident in the predictions it's making. All the predictions on this page are in the kind of 70 plus confidence range. So my model's really starting to work here, and I'm starting to feel good about it. Again, looks like it would like me to kind of make sure that's correct. It looks like it is. So this is very quick, very easy to evaluate and to train this up in terms of the model's performance. So I'm going to accept these, and I'm going to click next and move on to the next one. So you get the idea. My subject matter experts are able to easily label these and take advantage of them. So once I feel like this model is working, once I'm seeing those confidence scores, you know, in the 80s and 90s, I'm probably ready to try my model out. And that's the next module, which is Indico Review. Indico Review is truly explainable AI. You may have heard that term before, but the challenge with any AI-based approach is its explainability. And so we want to make sure that our customers at all times can try a model out and explain its performance to the organization, and in fact, sometimes to regulators, because they require to understand when you're using some kind of machine learning or AI, how exactly it's working. So you can see here, I've taken this particular invoice. This happens to be, we're using our own invoices for the demo here, but we got an invoice from AWS, which you can see on the screen there. We've pulled the text out of that invoice, and I've pasted into this try it out box. You can see if I scroll through here, I've just taken the text out of that invoice and pasted it in here. You'll notice that I've not preserved any of the structure of that invoice. I've purely taken the text out of it. Again, our solution doesn't rely on the location of the information on the document. You've also noticed that at no point in this demonstration did I create any kind of rules. There's no rule system at all underpinning this. The labeling I showed you on the previous screen is the full extent to the training required to build a custom model. So no rules, no keywords, no complicated document masking for OCR. I'm simply taking the text. I've taught a model how to interpret that text and correctly extract the elements in question. So if I click submit here, I'm going to try this out. And I've got my, you're now going to see the invoices loaded, and you can see what predictions it's made. So here's the vendor, that's correct. Here's the invoice number, that's correct. Here's the amount, that's correct. Here's a set of line items and line item prices. Those are all correct. And it continues down, more line items and more prices. And you can see that my explainability here, I'm able to click on any of these boxes if it got any of these wrong. In this case, it didn't. And understand what training data it used to make that prediction. And I can also search for any of these tokens and see if it made any omissions or if it by mistake recognized something that it shouldn't have. Obviously, for the demo here, this is a fairly simple one. We didn't find any errors. This one worked perfectly. So in just a few minutes, I was able to create a custom model, try a sample document out against it, and see its performance. And so you see how powerful this is an approach to unstructured content and automating these processes. If we pop back to our slides for a second here, just try to walk through a couple of case studies and then take your questions. Using us for trade order processing. Again, very typical setup here, heterogeneous trade orders being received from customers, usually PDF or oftentimes in the email itself, it'll say, please execute the following trade. This is the amount, this is the security, this is the from, this is the to, this is the date, all that just in the body of the email. Our ability to extract those elements using a custom model and then transform those for order processing dramatically impacted this process. 78% reduction in resources required to keep up with the volume of trades, and a 16x increase in the throughput on this particular process. This customer is now set up for very profitable growth. If they double their business next year, this system will keep up with that growth, and all of that incremental revenue will fall to the bottom line because there's no incremental cost to processing those documents. Contract analysis, a major insurance company we work with. This is a very common situation in a highly regulated space like insurance. If a new regulation is issued by the regulators, it can often have major impact in what the customer can offer in the market in terms of products and services. What happens often is it has to go back into the existing customer contracts and do an analysis of the various clauses in those documents to figure out which customers are now impacted by the new regulation. Historically, the customer would take 4 to 5 months to perform this. They would literally cut and paste clauses from their contracts and email them around to each other and score them, you know, manually as to whether they were in compliance or out of compliance and identify the customers needing contract remediation. We are able to simply create a model to do this with a few dozen customer contracts and annotation of the relevant clauses, process thousands of contracts in a matter of minutes, and dramatically cut down their contract review process when these regulatory impacts hit, and really help them drive new product launches faster with the confidence that they weren't having any kind of regulatory exposure by doing that. And then last case study here before questions, customer onboarding. In an institutional setting, customer onboarding is very complex, typically involving several dozen different documents and contracts. Requirements for KYC and anti-money laundering means that you have to extract the entities in question and be sure they're reviewed for KYC and AML compliance. This today in almost every institutional bank we've talked to involves a purely manual process of people opening all these documents, reading them, annotating them, pulling the relevant information out, pasting it into relevant systems, and really impacting the ability to onboard customers. And obviously the slower you onboard customers, the longer it takes to begin generating revenue from those customers. Well, at the same time, the regulatory environment has presented huge risk if you get this wrong. And so both the opportunity and the risk prevention here is just massive in customer onboarding. And in this case, we help the customer reduce the number of touches on those documents from 75 individual touches down to fewer than 10. So huge improvement in the efficiency of this process, as well as the robustness of it in terms of audit trail and governance and things like that. So we hope you enjoyed this presentation and learned something new today about breakthroughs in understanding unstructured content. I'm happy to take some questions now, and we'll go to the question pane here in the window and happy to take them as you have them.
All right, Tom, I've got a question here from one of our listeners. What are the common pitfalls you see when implementing an automation solution?
Yeah, I think that the most common is where there's not already a defined process in place. What AI is typically not good at is fixing a bad process. It can accelerate one, it can make it more efficient, it might be able to discover opportunities for automation, but a bad process is a bad process, and AI and automation will only serve to sort of set that bad process in concrete. So make sure that you've got a process that's well understood and working, even if it's very manual and slow and expensive. Those are great candidates for automation.
Great. Another question here from one of the listeners is, what is the typical amount of volume of data you typically need to get started?
So there's sort of two ways to think about that. There's the amount of training data, which is typically fewer than 100 representative examples. And they can be varied. They don't have to all be identical, but sort of a good range of example data in question. And then in terms of the amount of data that can be processed, well, that just scales on kind of an unlimited basis. I mean, that's the beauty of this is it stops being sort of volume dependent. It's capable of scaling at a tremendous rate to solve use cases where, we see use cases where there's several million documents being processed in a given month.
Great. Here's another one. Interesting question, I think. Will the model pick up on terms or words it has never seen before?
Yeah, one of the big advantages of the transfer learning approach is, again, it doesn't use keywords to understand the content. It's using something called text embeddings, and text embeddings operate at a lower level than the word level. Basically, it's very good at understanding the adjacencies around a given string of text. So when you have something that's out of vocabulary or an acronym, it typically can look at the surrounding information and where that information is coming from and identify what that acronym is representative of. So out of vocabulary is also handled much more robustly in AI-based frameworks than it is in, say, expert systems or keyword-based systems.
Great. I think what we'd like to do now is offer the folks on the webinar a free 30-minute use case discovery call with Tom, where you can go over the specific process automation use cases you might have in your organization. So we're gonna go ahead and launch that poll. If you're interested, just simply answer yes, and we'll follow up with you guys directly offline once we finish up here.
Great, well, thanks, Jeremy. Really enjoyed it. I hope the viewers enjoyed it as well, and we'd certainly be happy to follow up and answer specific questions generally about using AI to automate unstructured content or certainly any questions about Indico as well. And we hope that everyone has a good second half of the week here and enjoy talking to you today. Thanks a lot.